a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saved. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming.
You brought heaven down. Julia, I'm the Director of Ministries for Youth and Worship here at Coast Hills Community Church, where we are a Jesus-centered community creating gracious space through acts of generous love. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, so we celebrate and focus on the word hope. Each Sunday of Advent, I have gotten artists from our congregational community to express the word of Advent through art. And so this morning for hope, I took on that project. So as you'll be able to see, there is a canvas of pictures here. These pictures are from the year of 2020. As you can see, a lot has happened in 2020. Do you remember the fires that happened? That seemed like a long time ago, didn't it? There was Hong Kong protests, there was floods, there was the coronavirus, of course. 2020 was a very heavy year. There was a lot of need for hope, wasn't there? I don't know about you, but in my own life, I can reflect on ways that I needed hope as well. In fact, as I finished this this collage, I thought, maybe I should make one of my own personal life. What has happened to me in 2020 in which I need the longing of God? I thought about how I haven't seen my 100-year-old grandmother since March. I can't phone her because she's deaf. I can't see her, or she can't see me because she's blind. The way we communicate is through touch, which of course we can't do. And so I have been longing for hope, hope that I will be able to give my grandmother a hug when she turns 101 next month. Isn't that crazy? So what I did here is I put all of these pictures of 2020 up, but then I did hope, because friends, we are not without hope. Embedded in the word hope are the words of scripture. There were numerous scriptures that we can find which speak of God rescuing his people, of God being with us, of God restoring us. And this hope, this word of God, does not leave, that does not change. So even in this our own season of longing, of waiting, of desperation, of what feels like chaos and sadness, friends, we are not without hope. So this is the image that came to my mind as I prayed and asked God what he wanted me to fill this canvas with. I hope it brings encouragement to you. I hope that you can spend time in scripture when you are in need of hope and see how our God, our Emmanuel, God with us, delivers his people, that he is with us, that he will not forsake us. Amen, friends. So this morning, as I said, is the first Sunday of Advent. Hope. We light candles for the 4 weeks leading to Christmas and reflect on the coming of Christ. Christ is coming. Christ is always coming. Always entering a troubled world, a wounded heart. And so we light the first candle, the candle of hope, and dare to express our longing for hope, for healing, and the well-being of all creation. So I'm going to read from Isaiah 9:2 and 6-7 before I light the candle of hope. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all of eternity. Would you pray with me, my friends? Loving God, as we enter this Advent season, we open all the dark places in our lives and memories to the healing light of Christ. Show us the creative power of hope. Prepare our hearts to be transformed by you, that we may walk in the light of Christ. We want to let ourselves be surprised by wonder, The good news of Advent is this: Christ is coming. Christ is always coming. We welcome Christ into our hearts and lives. We go forth from this place in hope. Amen. For our youth series leading up to Christmas, we have begun a series of angels, of learning about angels' interactions in the Bible. So I thought it would be fitting to kick off this Advent series by singing Angels We Have Heard on High. So friends, let us sing.
Well, Coast Hills, I'm very excited and pleased to announce that we have our guest speaker, Brian Buhler, and he's agreed to teach alongside me during the Advent season at Coast Hills. I first met Brian over 10 years ago when Wayne Dreger invited me to play tennis with him and another pastor from the area. It happened to be Brian. We played a King's Court format that day, and I got whooped by both Wayne and Brian. I have not played since with him. I've also had the opportunity to be on the Cloverdale Pastoral Ministry group with him. And Brian has served as the lead pastor of Pacific Community Church in this area for several years. And we've had the opportunity to be together in a discipleship group as well called Surge that was for about 6 months together. I've grown to love and appreciate Brian as a friend, for his encouragement, for his wisdom, and his calming presence that he has. Brian lives right here in the Cloverdale area, and we're happy to have him with us for the next few weeks. So, welcome, Brian.
Hello, Coast Hills Church. Thank you so much for inviting me in to share this Advent season with you. I really feel quite akin to your church. I live just around the corner from the school where you used to meet before COVID. I played tennis with Pastor Wayne for at least a decade, and Kevin and I have become friends through the whole ministry that we went through with a whole bunch of pastors where we went through the Surge material, and I just feel really honored to be invited to share this moment with you. There's also a number of parishioners that I have known that attend your church for many years, like the faithful tech guy, Greg Strom. We go back over 40 years. I know the Wortmans, I know the Kirkhams, and there's probably a bunch of others that I know, and I just don't know that you attend Coast Hills. But anyway, thank you so much. Holy Spirit, come upon this teaching now and awaken us all to your wonderful wisdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, Pastor Kevin has introduced the whole subject of Advent, and I'm so grateful for that and to be involved in this. You know, one of the practical aspects of Advent is that it delays the celebration of Christmas. Now, this is going to be more difficult this year than in any year because I don't have to tell you, the year 2020, among other things, will be known as the year where people decorated for Christmas way before they ever had a right to do so. In fact, my wife and I have already put up two Christmas trees in our home. We have done the one thing that we said that we would never do throughout our married life, and that's decorate for Christmas in the middle of November. But of course, we've done it probably for the same reason that many of you have done it. We've longed for the warmth and the ambient light that comes from Christmas decor. Thankfully, from a liturgical point of view, or from a point of view that looks at how the church celebrates the life of Christ through the church calendar, Advent prevents us from celebrating Christmas prematurely. It sort of does for Christmas what Lent does for Easter. It says, no, don't take the turkey out of the freezer. Don't do it. Leave it there. Don't open up that expensive bottle of wine. Not yet. It's way too early for that. Advent says, I know you're hungry for a change, but don't turn stones into bread. Don't do it. Don't end the fast prematurely. Rather, trust your Heavenly Father while you're still in the dark. Advent kind of holds our feet to the ground of exile and says, exile's going to come to an end, but for now, let him who walks in the dark who has no light trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. Advent. From kind of a biblical point of view, Advent leads the church to revisit that dark time in history before the birth of Christ in Bethlehem. You know, in the days of Caesar Augustus, when Quirinius was governor over Judah, those were dark days indeed, days of Roman occupation. Those were days where the Jewish king himself was a despot. He was narcissistic and paranoid. He was violent. He ordered the execution of all the baby boys in Bethlehem under the age of two when he heard that there was a rival king who was born. And now we live in dark days. I don't have to tell you that. There's so much about the world in which we live in prior to the second coming of Christ that reminds us of what life was like before the first coming of Christ. And to help us get a grip on this Advent season, our Christian forefathers ensured that the Bible readings that the church engages in before Christmas would focus primarily on the Old Testament prophets, and particularly the prophet Isaiah. And the deep sense of longing that the ancient Israelites felt while waiting for the Messiah to come. So Advent refuses to be triumphalistic. It refuses to say, hey, it's okay. Everything's okay. When in fact, it's not okay. And everybody knows it's not okay. But what Advent does do is it prime the pump of our faith and our hope. It looks toward the second coming of Christ, where the new heavens and the new earth are ushered in when Jesus returns. Christians call this the blessed hope. That's what we're doing right now. It's what we're doing in the first Sunday of Advent. Now, in the 7th or 8th century, some very faithful monks composed for the benefit of the church what we would call the O Antiphons. Kevin has already primed the pump with you about this. These are brief scriptural texts that are either sung or chanted antiphonally. So I would start the chant or the song, and you would respond back and forth. And we're the most familiar with these antiphons through the Advent carol, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, each verse paralleling one of the antiphons. And I think Greg is going to put up on the screen the 7 antiphons, but I will just tell you what they are. These are all from Isaiah. O Wisdom, O Lord of Might, O Root of Jesse, O Key of David, O Dayspring or Morning Star, O King of Gentiles, or Desire of Nations. You might recognize those from the hymn, but you also will recognize these as descriptive names that Isaiah uses for Jesus Christ. And this morning, our focus is going to be on 2 of them, on Christ, our wisdom, and Christ, our power. So here's the text, and this will be the text for the next few weeks. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 to 6. Follow along as I read. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of the knowledge of the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord, and he will not judge by what his eyes see or decide on what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy, and with justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist, and the wolf will live with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. All right, let's just take a minute and kind of get our head around this idea of Old Testament prophecy. When an Old Testament prophet like Isaiah spoke a prophetic word for the people of God in which he was living, most often there was an immediate fulfillment of that prophecy and a fulfillment that would take place in 100 years, 1,000 years, and 10,000 years. So in other words, one prophetic utterance would be good for immediate, and it would be good for way far into the future. So for example, Jeremiah the prophet had a dream one night, and he went and stood before the people and he said, I had a dream of a boiling pot coming from the north and the contents being dumped out onto Israel. Well, that's a fulfillment that took place shortly after it was spoken. He was talking about King Nebuchadnezzar bringing his Babylonian armies to come and to attack Israel because of their apostasy. God had allowed it. In fact, God had ordered it. And so there was an immediate fulfillment. But many of these prophecies, whether Jeremiah's or Isaiah's, also pointed way far into the future and pointed to the coming of a Messiah who would bring both judgment and salvation, both restoring Israel and all the other nations of the earth. So though there was a negative aspect to the prophecy, it foretold the judgment of God, there was also a hope-filled message that a leader was coming who would lead differently than any leader who had ever led before. And of course, we know this person to be Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. But here's the critical point, and it's an interesting point. The prophecy that would come out of the mouth of the prophet would foretell the entire story of Jesus in just three or four verses. So for example, you've got our text before us today, chapter 11, verses 1 to 6, and it begins with the birth of Jesus. A shoot will come out of the stump of Jesse. But then it jumps 30 years ahead to the Holy Spirit coming upon this man. Well, that happened at Jesus' baptism. And then it goes into verses 2 and 4, which talk about the kind of ministry he's going to have. It's a unique ministry of wisdom, where he serves and leads from the fear of the Lord, or out of the fear of the Lord. And then it says that he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. Well, we never saw Jesus do that because he hasn't done that yet. That's going to come at the second coming of Christ. And then our text ends with, and the wolf will lie down with the lamb, and a child will lead them. A child will play beside the viper's nest. All of those great texts that talk about how war will come to an end and nations will stop rising up against each other and there will be true peace on the earth. Well, that's not going to happen for a long time yet unless Jesus returns very soon. So the whole life of Jesus from his birth to the new heavens and the new earth jammed together in six short verses. Now, some of you may be saying, didn't Isaiah miss something really important, like the death of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of Jesus? Good catch. Yes, he did miss it here. But if we just keep reading through the book of Isaiah, more and more prophecies come out. And by the time we get to chapter 53, we hear these verses, "For he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement that brought us peace with God was laid upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." And then he talks about the burial of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus, that he will rise with healing in his wings. Isaiah leaves nothing behind. The whole life of Jesus, from before he was born in Bethlehem all the way to the new heavens and the new earth, in one book. And a lot of it just in a few short verses. So here's our brief thought this morning. We want to focus on verse 2. The Spirit of the Lord will rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom, and the Spirit of counsel and power. We want to let these two verses, and particularly these two names of Christ, O Wisdom and O Lord of Might, and the relationship between wisdom and power, we want to see these two things shape our vision for Jesus today so that we can follow him more closely and worship him in a fulfilling way, worship him as he really is. And we will conclude this morning with a challenge or an application for how we might embody this kind of wisdom in these crazy days in which we find ourselves living right now. Okay, why would it have been such good news for Isaiah's audience to hear that from the stump of Jesse, a green shoot would spring up, that this man or this green shoot would be anointed by the Holy Spirit, and particularly it would be the Spirit of wisdom? Why would that have been such good news for them? What mental image would immediately come to mind? Well, it would be the image of Samuel, the kingmaker, coming to the house of Jesse, asking Jesse to line up all of his sons, and Samuel finally pouring the horn of oil out on the least likely, the youngest green shoot of Jesse's family, David. And the text says that from that moment forward, the Holy Spirit came upon David in power. David served like no other king had ever served. From that moment forward, the spirit of wisdom was upon him. And unlike his predecessor, King Saul, David manifested the right kind of wisdom and the right kind of power. Saul, on the other hand, didn't lead from wisdom. He did not seek counsel from God. He didn't fear the Lord. He actually sought counsel from the witch of Endor. He led out of fear and paranoia. And though the people loved him at the beginning, they could begin to see what was happening. And David, on the other hand, would rule with wisdom because the spirit of wisdom was upon him. Now, as wise as David was, his latter years reflected some folly. And even his son Solomon, you know, famous for being the wisest man who ever lived, perhaps, ended poorly because it says his many wives led his heart astray to worship false gods. So even at the what we would call the height of the entire Davidic monarchy, divine wisdom was lacking. And they were heading towards folly. By the time Isaiah speaks the words that we just read here in chapter 11, God's people had had it. They had had so many kings, most of them wicked. They would use their political power to build alliances with other powerful people in an attempt to prolong their rule. And as a result, they cared not about the average person. They didn't care for the poor or for the alien. They cared only about themselves. King Rehoboam, for example, needed some good advice on how to lead, so he went to the elders of the city and said, "Can you give me some wisdom on how to be a good leader?" And remembering the days back to David, they said, "Yes, lead like this." Let me read it for you. This is 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 7. "If you will be a servant to these people today and serve them and answer them and speak good words to them, then they will be your servants forever." Well, that was really sage advice. But the Bible says that Rehoboam didn't like the advice and he went advice shopping. You know, that's when you look for somebody who is too afraid to speak truth to power and you basically find somebody who agrees with you. And so he went to his young buddies and said, "How do you think I should lead?" And they told him, but they gave him very poor advice and the consequences were devastating. 1 Kings says that Israel suffered for 40 years under unwise leadership. Now, by the time Isaiah writes these words, the nation of Israel was asking, "Is there any hope for us? Will we ever see wisdom again? Would God ever give us a leader who would lead out of wisdom and with integrity, who would seek counsel from God, who would fear God, who would provide justice to the needy, somebody who wouldn't just look out for himself, but would truly do the work of the Lord among the people?" And Isaiah answers their question. "Yes, a shoot will come up from the devastated forest floor of Israel's apostasy. Out of the family of Jesse," he said. And the people would have gone, "Jesse? He's going to come from the tribe of Jesse? Will he be like Jesse's son? Will he be like David?" And Isaiah's answer is basically, "Well, yes, he will be a little bit like David, but he'll be way better than David because not only will he be the fruit or the shoot coming out of Jesse, he will be the root underneath Jesse." That would have been so mind-blowing for them, a little bit like when Jesus said to the Pharisees, "Before Abraham was born, I am." These verses from Isaiah are describing Jesus of Nazareth, who pre-existed his friends and family in Nazareth. And here's the simple thing that I want us to see today. Jesus would rule his people like no other king they had ever had. He was and is unique as a man of wisdom. And what Isaiah wants us to see is that his uniqueness is the result of having the Holy Spirit come upon him. Now, I have to say this, that in the Old Testament, there were many men and women who experienced the filling and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, different from the way we do, but the Spirit still came upon people, upon builders and artists and technicians, upon architects and prophets and priests, upon anybody who was given any task at all to serve for the glory of God. The Spirit came upon them for a period of time, and then the Spirit would actually leave them. The anointing came and the anointing left. The difference between Jesus and Old Testament anointing is that when the Holy Spirit came upon Jesus at his baptism, it says the dove landed upon him and did not leave. The dove remained on Jesus. The dove found his true home in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. And so the Lord, from that moment forward, would not do anything without it being in the full cooperation of his Father and fully dependent on the Holy Spirit, who had filled him in a unique way at his baptism. The anointing upon Jesus, the leader, was unique. Theologians call it the sevenfold ministry of the Spirit, or the ministry of the Spirit that by nature is complete and perfect. Now, think for a moment of what the wisdom of Jesus looked like when he walked around the ancient Palestine as a king, as a rabbi, leaning on the Spirit and seeking the Father's counsel. It was impossible for his enemies to stump him, to derail him, or to confuse him. His wisdom led him to say and do the right thing every time. Imagine if you had that kind of wisdom, whether it was showing tenderness to children when nobody expected it, kindness and respect to women in a patriarchal society, grace to outcasts and sinners, appropriate contempt for Pharisees, hospitality to aliens like the Syrophoenician woman. Whatever it was, his responses were almost always surprising. And this is because Jesus was representing the upside-down leadership of heaven. The world actually had not seen this kind of wisdom before. He was filled with the Holy Spirit that came down out of heaven. The wisdom of Jesus was heavenly. And when he has an opportunity to preach in his hometown of Nazareth, you know this, it was Isaiah 61 that he opened up, and this is what he read. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. Isaiah's prophecy had come true in the person of Jesus Christ, the man of wisdom. One other thing I want us to see before we land this plane. There's something else in the text that sets Jesus apart from all other kings and leaders, and it really compels us to place our trust in him today. Verse 3 says, "He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or hears with his ears." That's interesting, isn't it? What can this mean but that Jesus will act justly and compassionately, not on the basis of what's obvious to the rest of us, by using our five senses, by what we see and what we hear. Rather, look at verse 4, but with righteousness, or with right relatedness to his Father, he will judge the needy, and with justice he will give decisions to the poor of the earth. All right, that's the lesson. Here's one observation and then one challenge. Here's the observation. So when Jesus arrived, when he was born and this prophecy was fulfilled, that the man of wisdom would come, the people didn't want his kind of wisdom, because it was inconsistent with their kind of power. If a king is truly wise, so they thought, he would use his wisdom to destroy his enemies and to power up when threatened and to crush all opponents with force. Every wise king would just send in the tanks when the nation was threatened. But the kind of wisdom that Jesus embodied was the exact opposite. It was the wisdom and power of the cross. The wisdom of Jesus was the self-sacrificing love that pours itself out for its enemies, even the Romans. And this was illustrated beautifully a couple of weeks ago. I saw the message where Kevin preached on Mary, the mother of, or the sister of Martha, breaking open the expensive bottle of perfume and pouring out all the contents onto Jesus in an act of worship. And do you remember what Judas and the other disciples thought of it? They thought it was pure folly. They didn't think it was the way of wisdom at all. Paul sums it up like this. He says, where is the wise man? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what we preached to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs. Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Ah, there Paul actually quotes. I wonder if he's thinking about Isaiah chapter 11, where wisdom and power are listed in the same verse. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. That's the observation. When wisdom finally arrived, they didn't want it because it was inconsistent with their view of power. And finally, a challenge for the church, for all of us. In these crazy days in which we're living, we are witnessing various examples and styles or models of leadership. Many of these leaders are boasting both wisdom and power. But we must always remember this in light of our text, that when the world zigs, the church zags. When worldly wisdom powers up, the church lays her life down in self-sacrificing love. When the worldly wisdom crushes, the church goes cruciform. The kingdom of heaven never advances or never succeeds by parroting the kingdom of the world. And it's interesting that the Bible ends with the book of Revelation with two kinds of wisdom being compared and contrasted, the way of the Lamb and the way of the dragon. It's always appropriate for us who are leaders, leaders of homes, leaders of churches, leaders of business, leaders of countries, to ask the question, does my leadership reflect the power of self-sacrificing love? If it doesn't, it could be that we're more enamored with the dragon than we are with the Lamb. But the good news is that for this challenge, we, like Jesus, have also received the Spirit of wisdom. Jesus has baptized us with the same Spirit that he was baptized with. So by God's grace, may we all live into this unique, one-of-a-kind kind of wisdom as we live in union with Jesus. Lord knows, the world desperately needs a new model of wisdom. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Oh, 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 oh.
now, church, receive this Advent benediction. Be people of hope. Let your hope live in your heart and share this hope with all. Share hope by noticing somebody else's humanity. Share hope by listening to somebody's story. Share hope by praying for the world. In this Advent season, we need to see, to feel, to experience, and to share Christ's hope. As you go out into the wonder of God's creation this week, share hope with those you meet. Amen.
Breaking through the silence with glory in the highest, the hope of all creation resting in his mother's arms. A song on the horizon ringing through the heavens, the long-awaited Savior to set the captives free. Come to set the captives free. Come set us free. Redemption, what started in a man.